calling to the faraway towns. Now war is declared and battle come down. London calling to the underworld. Come out of the cupboard, you boys and girls. Good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome back. For those of you who've just joined, my name's Dr. Lisa Spencer, and I'm a lung doctor who works in Liverpool. And we're about to start our second session in our patient education day today. And we're now zipping down to London from Liverpool, and we are going to join the team at the Royal Brompton Hospital in London. And we're so grateful for them helping out with today and doing this session for us. So hello to the London team, and I hope you liked your introductory music there by The Clash. So this session is just over an hour long probably, and it's going to start with a talk by Professor Athol Wells, which I'll come back to in a second. And then after that, we've mocked up a multi-professional meeting of interstitial lung disease team members. So we're going to take you into a sort of fly on the wall documentary about how we discuss the results of the patients and the scans and things, and how we come up with the best diagnosis we can from all the information that we have. And sometimes management is discussed and decided perhaps at those meetings too. So I think that'll be really interesting for patients to see the beating heart of how a service runs and how we use all the skills of all our different healthcare professionals to come up to, for a good diagnosis and management plan. Anyway, before that, it is my huge pleasure to introduce our next speaker. Our next speaker is Professor Athol Wells. Thank you, ABC. So Professor Wells, the reason for the music is, and he will be embarrassed that I'm saying this, but I'm going to embarrass you, Athol, I do apologise. Professor Athol Wells, to us in the ILD community, quite frankly, is ILD royalty. He is a leader and a mover and a shaker within the field of interstitial lung disease, and I feel very honoured to know this man. He is very precious to us. He is the senior ILD consultant at the Royal Brompton Hospital in London, which is the largest ILD centre in the UK. And he also has an amazing international reputation and is a well-known expert in this field. This gentleman has published more papers in this field than you can shake a stick at, and he is one of the most cited authors internationally and has transformed the field, certainly in my opinion and in the opinion of many of my colleagues. So Athol, sorry to embarrass you, because I know you'll be embarrassed by the introduction, but you are an ILD hero, and it's a great pleasure to have you here today and to do this talk for us. And I think you're going to talk about a general approach to the ILD diagnosis. So I pass over the microphone to your great wisdom, Athol, and thank you so much for being here today. It's fantastic to have you.
Lisa, I wonder if you would like to travel with me and give this introduction for each of my talks. And I like the principle of the music. I actually will start to play this before I comment on our weekly multidisciplinary meeting, I think. I'm going to try to cut through the mystique of diagnosis in ILD and get to the heartbeat of what we do, because it is terribly confusing for several reasons when you first come to this. So why should we make an exact diagnosis? Why not just call most people as having pulmonary fibrosis, for which there are perhaps 1,000 variants? Why do we actually insist on trying to be precise? Next slide. With an exact diagnosis, you have knowledge of the range of what is possible to happen in the future, either without treatment or with treatment. And this varies from diagnosis to diagnosis. Once you know this, you can choose the right treatment goals, and you can monitor the situation tailored to the goals to make sure the goals are being achieved. And sometimes, less often than you might think, but sometimes an exact diagnosis does guide you to a treatment that may be helpful in an individual disease. Next slide. And I want to get to the heart of the problem, I think. In our field, we have a huge number of individual disorders, But as I will show you, we have only a handful of logical treatment goals. I don't need to stress the unfriendly nature of the terminology. Read the slide and shudder. And indeed, the same treatment goals and the same individual treatments cover many people that have very different disorders by name. And in some disorders, different people have differences in the way in which the disease behaves. Next slide. So you have to forget the complexity, and I make this point to trainees in the field and often to colleagues. With an exact diagnosis, it's good if you have it, because it allows you to know as a doctor what to say to patients and colleagues about that disease and that individual, and what to do about it. Next slide. This carries me. I wonder if I'm missing a slide which was in my talk, which I sent to you, Sujal. Can we go back a slide, please? Okay, can we in that case go forward? And this, I think, will do. When we confront a disease and forget about idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, there are five things we can do. And this applies to all chronic diseases. We can leave it alone if it's limited and is likely to go away by itself, especially if you can find a trigger which you can remove. We can leave it alone because it is past history. There's been an active process in the past and it's left a footprint behind, but it's not going to get worse. You monitor to make sure that's the case, but you don't have to move to treatment. We can try to remove some or all of it. If we can't do that, we can try to stop it getting worse. If we can't do that, we can try to slow it down. Next slide. Yeah, that was the slide that preceded it. So I think that if you consider the diagnosis of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, we can simply only try to slow disease down as our treatment goal with that diagnosis. But we can slow it down on average by 3 years, and that is a hugely good goal. Next slide. And from this thought process, I put forward to the last reclassification, diagnoses based on what are you going to do about it, as opposed to diagnoses that give you a huge number of different disorders. And you can see here, this just does summarize the five things you could try to do with a disease, making a disease behavior diagnosis. And at the bottom of the five, you have typical idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, but you can immediately see that with making a diagnosis, we're trying to place individuals into the right treatment goals and monitoring strategies. Next slide. So let's just consider the approach to diagnosis. First of all, the history. And we need to know whether there are triggers of either scarring pulmonary fibrosis, inflammation, or a mixture of the two. So we have to think about things in the environment, features that suggests that there's a general autoimmune problem with misbehavior of the immune system, exposures from the workplace, or treatments, a wide range of drugs that can actually cause interstitial lung disease. Is there a family history? And even if you don't get symptoms, is there an existing diagnosis of, say, rheumatoid arthritis that might be driving the problem? Next slide. Now, ideally, physical examination adds to assessing diagnosis. This actually influences the diagnosis at times, but much less than you might think. And probably this has been just as well in the last 2 years, because of course COVID has not allowed us to examine many people with interstitial lung disease face to face. Often a good referral letter tells you what is needed. But we have a study that does demonstrate that with very expert evaluation, the diagnosis changes about a quarter of the time. Next slide. What I will say is that on average, the history gives you 90% of what is needed for the clinician part of the evaluation. Before CT, the physical examination was often crucial, and it is the arrival of CT that has actually often trumped physical examination, but not always. Next slide. There are blood tests, and there are always general blood tests to know about whatever else might be going on. There are screening blood tests to try to find triggers, and I'm talking here about general autoimmune blood tests, and occasionally these have to be a lot more detailed. You talk to somebody, and although it has not been identified that they may have an autoimmune problem, a detailed conversation can reveal that, and the blood tests become more complex. Next slide. And then you have CT. Now, I'm not going to say anything about this, obviously, with the lineup of the speakers, but just to say that on average, what the clinician does and what the CT radiologist does give you roughly equal diagnostic information. And sometimes one of these two things is conclusive and the other is not, and you have to put them together. What you should never do is over rely on CT. And I like to actually talk to someone before I look at their scan, because if I look at the scan first, that biases me in what I'm asking the patient. Now, not everyone can do that in a busy practice, but I do see that as the ideal. Next slide. Lung function tests in passing. Surprisingly, these do occasionally influence the likely diagnosis, but this is relatively rare. And generally, we are measuring these to establish how severe a problem is, and you put that together with symptoms, and then you've got a baseline and you can look at change in lung function to see what is happening with time. Next slide. At the end of all of this, you are bringing what is found to a discussion where you are weighing how conclusive the clinician is, how conclusive the radiologist is. It's negotiation and reconciliation. And if the diagnosis can be made, no further diagnostic tests are needed, but sometimes they are. Now, if a diagnosis is not definite, do you always have to go to a biopsy? Plainly not. If you have bad lung function, if you have other illnesses, if you are above a certain age, and above all, I think, if the patient is telling you, having heard the risk and benefit, that they don't want a biopsy, you often have to make what is called a working diagnosis. So you're not at 100%. And very often you are at 70 to 90% likely. And the diagnosis you have reached is the logical diagnosis to guide therapy. Next slide. And from this, and this is, I think, a terrific paper put together by Chris Ryerson, an honor to be part of that group, we can make a diagnosis that is established more than 90% likely, or it can be it said provisional, I mean a working diagnosis, and it can be confident or less in confidence. And sometimes there are two or three diagnostic possibilities, and you can't reach a first choice above 50%. We call that unclassifiable. But I do have to say to you, and I'll say it again, most of the time, you can actually see clearly what the logical treatment goal is and how it should be monitored. So you can make a disease behavior diagnosis that is 100% confidence, even if you can't put an exact polysyllabic jargon-written term to exactly label the diagnosis. Next slide. And I think it's very like the Cheshire Cat, the act of making a diagnosis. This is Alice hearing from the Cheshire Cat, if you don't know where you are going, any road will get you there. So remembering the appearance and disappearance of the cat, in making a diagnosis, sometimes you can see the cat very well. Next slide. And that is an established diagnosis. Sometimes, next slide, you are actually reaching a working diagnosis. You can't be exact, but depending on how confident or a provisional diagnosis is, you can see a lesser or greater amount of the cat. And sometimes, next slide, you have to say that putting an exact label on the diagnosis cannot be achieved. And actually, it is damaging if you persuade yourself that you have to do that, because you have a severe risk of misleading management and misleading the patient. You've got to be honest about that. Internationally, 20 to 30% of cases on average have unclassifiable disease, although happily, I think we can say on our own data that we run at just below 10% in our unit. Next slide. And I come back to biopsy. You've got to remember that a surgical biopsy may give you 100% precision. It doesn't always, but it can do. But there's a mortality on average of 2%, and that rises over the age of 65. You've really got to judge whether the lack of inflammation is more dangerous than doing a procedure. And this has to be driven by partnership, and you have to respect the views of the patient. Next slide. I want to make two final points very briefly. Next slide. If you break down the frequency of diagnoses that cause problems, and this is a terrific study which actually looked at therapy in those patients who actually had worsening despite treatment. Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis was not in this study, but all other types were. So you can award idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis about a quarter of cases, and in the remainder, about a quarter had hypersensitivity pneumonitis, a quarter had an autoimmune lung disease. Idiopathic NSIP, which I won't go into, it's one of those names, but a less progressive disorder on average, about 20%, and unclassifiable, about 17%. And finally, in the next slide, it may be helpful to summarize what we do in a multidisciplinary meeting. We can be accused of being blind men examining an elephant. In order to get the overall picture, the blind men have to talk to each other. And what you see in this slide is a pathologist, a clinician, and on the right, an artist impression of Professor Desai as a radiologist considering a difficult case. Last slide. So in summary, it's great if you can reach an exact diagnosis. Worldwide in disease, people view 95% as exact. It guides you on what to say and what to do, and you have to be meticulous, but you have also to accept that diagnostic uncertainty exists. And when it does, you can generally find a sensible treatment approach that covers the possibilities. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Wells. You have beautifully outlined what is a hugely complex process, and hopefully the patients will find that useful to hang a frame to hang how we process things in ILD. It's a very complex topic to cover. Thank you for doing that so well. So a couple of things I just want to mention. Thank you so much to everyone for all the questions that you're putting into the Q&A box, and you're all putting it into the right box, which is great. I can see that we've had over 70 questions already this morning, and thank you to all my colleagues, because we've actually answered over 60 of those already on the meeting live. So thank you to all the speakers for picking up the questions and the team. Just a reminder, it's very difficult for us to answer questions that are about your individual case, because we don't have all the information to give you an appropriate answer. So general questions are good, but if they're about your individual case, it'd be quite tricky for us to give information when we don't have all the details. But we'll do our best to answer them as best we can, and any that we don't get to live during the meeting today, we will try and get back to you later. APF will send I think responses out to people. So it's a great pleasure now to move on to the next session. So we are about to now dip into a multi-professional interstitial lung disease meeting, exactly like one that we've mocked up a meeting that would be held like a real meeting at the Brompton. And at this point, in a moment, I'm going to hand over to the chair for the next session. And I'm hoping that Dr. George, who's going to chair the session, will do a brief introduction of his colleagues. So I'm going to hand over to Peter George, who is one of the consultants at the Royal Brompton in London. He's a very well-known personality and consultant within the ILD world, and we're very lucky to have all these consultants here from London with us today. So I'll hand over to Dr. George, and if that's okay, Pete, if you could introduce your panel, that would be most welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lisa. Well, thank you, first of all, for inviting us to come and speak and to be part of this fantastic day. It's a real honour to be here. It's the second of our ILD patient days, and it's always really humbling to have this opportunity, and we're very grateful for it. I don't know why Athol has taken his camera off, but he's very much part of the next session. I'm sure he will join us, here we are, again soon. We over the next 40 minutes or so, we are going to talk through a few cases in the way that we might do if we were sitting in our multidisciplinary team meeting. And that's what the MDT stands for, multidisciplinary team, where we discuss a number of cases and walk through what we think the diagnoses may be and then potentially approaches to treatment later on. And we have a very, as Lisa does at Aintree and our colleagues across the country do, we have a very interactive and enjoyable MDT where we spend a lot of time challenging each other to make sure that we, at the end of it, can bring together the best possible outcome for the patient, for you as patients. And that means really interrogating each other to make sure that the histories are correct, the imaging is what we think it is, and we know how best to take forward treatment.
I'm speaking remotely.
Athol, Professor Wells has already introduced himself to you and has given us a wonderful talk which outlines the way in which we think about diagnosis. But Sujal, can I ask you please to introduce yourself and then Alex thereafter, and then we can start.
Hi, Pete. Yeah, thanks very much. Just reiterating what Peter said, it's a pleasure and an honour to be here. It's the second of our ILD days, and we hope there are going to be more. I'm a radiology consultant. I've worked with Peter and the team for the last 5 years while I've been at Brompton, and I've worked with Athol even longer. So if during this MDT you find that we're teasing each other, it's only because we're great friends. But that's how our MDT runs as well. Thank you very much, Pete.
And Alex, thank you, Sujal.
Hi, yes, I'm a consultant histopathologist, so I sit at the microscope all day. I have great pleasure of working with this MDT for the last 10 years and with my colleague who is a well-recognised international expert in histopathology, Professor Andrew Nicholson, who unfortunately can't be here today. And I've known him for the last 20 years. So again, very, very honoured to be invited to be part of this.
Thank you, Alex. So typically in our MDT, you'll have a number of physicians, so myself, Athol, and others. You'll have radiologists, whose expertise, of course, is the imaging, and you'll have pathologists whose expertise, like Alex and Andrew's, is very much looking at any tissue that we might, any biopsy material that we might have to talk about diagnoses. So I think without any further ado, we will start with our first case. And just to say that these cases are all real cases that have gone through our meeting, and there is no right or wrong answer, which is why we spend time thinking about what's happening and how best to manage things. So I'm going to challenge my colleagues on the MDT, as they would expect me to, and ask them difficult questions as we go along. And Lisa, you can feel free to ask me difficult questions at any time that you wish to, at which point I will then pass them on to others. So our first case is a 67-year-old male patient who was referred to our clinic by one of our network teams in a different hospital with progressive breathlessness and a cough. Now, when we say they didn't have any exposures or connective tissue disease features, that means we, in the history, could not identify any features that might drive us towards a specific diagnosis. So exposures might be elements like, do they have any specific mold in their home that they're exposed to? Do they have any birds, parrots, pigeons, budgies? These are exposures that we talk about. And connective tissue disease features are features that might make us think there was an autoimmune process. So is the immune system overacting, misbehaving in a way which it is, which means that it is attacking the lungs to cause inflammation and potentially scarring? And some of those features we ask about include, do your fingers change colour in the cold? Do you have joint pains in the morning? Do you have joint stiffness? Do you have muscle pains? And very open questions. I mean, if you ask most of us, we have muscle pains in the morning, but it's trying to identify which of those really are associated with an immune problem and which are just the natural course of the years taking their toll. Serology means blood tests. So in the blood tests, are there any clues that might help us? So an autoimmune screen is a panel of blood tests which we do when we see patients for the first time, looking for any signs of an autoimmune condition. So conditions such as rheumatoid arthritis or systemic sclerosis or lupus. Those are conditions which can be associated with our conditions with lung fibrosis and lung inflammation. Now, precipitins, again, very technical terms, but these just simply mean, are there any features or markers in the blood tests which might make us think that there is some exposure that the patient was not aware of? So, for example, we look for proteins in the blood that might be related to pigeons or birds or mold. And sometimes when we see those, we may then go back to the patient and say, are you sure you don't raise pigeons? And they might say, well, I'm pretty sure I would have remembered that. But that's why your consultants might come back to you and ask questions which might seem silly. And it's because there's been a clue that's come up through the blood test that might have assisted, help us work through it. And so these are the PFTs, which stand for the pulmonary function tests or the lung function tests. And Athol, I might ask you to reflect on these and help us understand what they might mean for a patient.
Well, what you see here is two broad types of measurement. Firstly, how efficiently can air be moved inside, into and out of the lungs? And those measures are captured most strongly by the FEV1 and FVC. And in this patient, the level is officially normal. The normal range is 80 to 120% of what is predicted from age, gender, and height, but that goes to show that we actually do not know everything that drives normality in lung function, that range. However, the key test here is a test that captures the whole efficiency of the lungs, not just ability to breathe in and out, but how oxygen is taken up in blood vessels, and that is the DLCO. And you can see immediately that there is quite a major problem with a level of 37%, which is less than half of the lower limit of normal. This tells us immediately that to rely just on the routine tests that are done in GP surgeries and can be done rapidly, the two top tests, that's going to be very misleading in many people. You're not actually capturing the disease process.
Athol, so what we're saying is that the DLCO, the gas transfer, is probably how efficiently the lung can use oxygen. What does the KCO mean, and what does that tell us? Why do we look at that?
The gas transfer is everything, not just the oxygen. It's an addition of uptake of oxygen and breathing in and out. What you see here is that the gas transfer is a lot lower than it ought to be because the lung volumes are efficiently normal. The KCO captures that. You can say that it's capturing how disproportionate the gas transfer is. And that is very often a clue that there is a problem in pulmonary blood vessels and they don't influence your ability to breathe in and out. And that in turn makes you query whether there might be an autoimmune problem, or maybe there's also emphysema as well as pulmonary fibrosis. Those are the two scenarios that give this sort of picture. So coming to the scan, I will be very interested to see if there is emphysema. And otherwise, maybe underneath, there is a hidden autoimmune problem.
Well, as if on cue, Sujal, perhaps you can talk us through these complicated pictures.
Thanks, Pete. Now this is not the full scan. When we do a scan, I know you've heard a little bit about the tests that are done in patients this morning. When we do a CT scan, we actually capture the whole lung, as it were. So we ask you to take a deep breath, and then the scanner moves from top to bottom while you're holding your breath. It's not possible to show every single image because often we're reviewing about 300, 350, 400 images sometimes on a screen. So what I've chosen here are sections through the lungs. This is, can you see my mouse move on there, Pete? You probably...
No.
Okay,
no.
So I'll say it. So the top left image is in the upper zone. Then the top right image is a little bit lower down where the airways are dividing. Then the bottom two images are even further down. And they show, firstly, that the lungs are abnormal. And how do I know that the lungs are abnormal? Well, most lungs, or most normal lungs, will look sort of uniformly black, except for the vessels and the airways that course through them normally. In this lung, however, it's not uniformly black. There are abnormalities which look a bit grayer or a bit whiter than they should. And most importantly here, there are signs that this is a fibrotic lung disease. Now, the way we say that there is a fibrotic lung disease is by looking for a number of signs. One is a sign that we call reticulation. Reticulation comes from the Latin reticulare, to mean net-like. So what we're looking at is crisscrossing lines. And this image does show an appearance where in places there are crisscrossing lines, for example, in the top left image. Another important sign is something that we call traction bronchiectasis. That's jargon, doctors or radiologists' jargon, for airways that are pulled apart. Now, again, in the normal lung, as we go from the trachea and we travel down the lung, the airways get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, resembling effectively a tree. So if you think of a tree, you have the trunk of the tree, which is very large, which is equivalent to our trachea. And as we go further and further out into the lungs, the branches get smaller and smaller. That's exactly what happens in the normal lung. However, if you have scarring or fibrosis in the lungs, then you get tractional forces because the fibrosis pulls from all directions and it dilates those airways. And that sign is crucially important. When we see that sign, we know whatever else is going on, there is fibrosis in the lungs. So that's an important sign. In this patient,
I didn't get that. Could you try again?
That's my Siri talking back to me. It thinks I'm teaching it. So apologies. So this patient definitely has lung fibrosis. The other thing which is very important on a CT scan is we look at the distribution of disease, because there are some diseases that like the lower zones. IPF is a disease which classically starts in the lower zones and then builds upwards and inwards. There are some diseases like sarcoid which like the upper zones. So disease distribution is very, very important. Now, this one is a little bit difficult, and I think you mentioned right at the beginning, the MDT is the place where we discuss these difficult cases. This patient definitely has fibrosis, but I don't think it has a classical appearance of IPF. In other words, it's not mainly in the lower zones. I can see abnormality on the top two images where there is evidence of fibrosis. That's not very classical for IPF. So I would have difficulty, and I suspect I did at the MDT have difficulty. I would certainly say this is a fibrotic lung disease. I don't think I'd be able to make a confident diagnosis of a UIP apnea, mainly because of the distribution, where I think there's just too much going on in the upper zones. So at best, I would have probably called this indeterminate for UIP. In other words, there are features on here which tell me there is fibrosis, but there are other features which are pushing me in another direction, but I don't have enough features for me to say, this is sarcoid or this is hypersensitive pneumonitis. So it's one of those difficult cases which we see at plenty of our MDT meetings, and this is where the MDT really comes to life, and this is where the discussion really starts.
Well, I mean, thank you, Sujal. I could tell that you were, that was a long way of telling us that you think that it might be UIP, but I could see also Athol was twitching halfway through, as he sometimes does. Athol.
He often twitches a lot, but we...
So UIP means idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis in this context, just to be clear. And I think you would agree that it isn't absolutely ruled out, because it can sometimes look unusual. But my question to you is whether the blood vessels, the pulmonary artery, looks normal. We've got a clue that from the lung function that that might be an issue.
Well, the top right-hand image, we've just about, as I said, we haven't got all the images. Normally, we look at about 350 to 400 images. But the top right-hand image just captures the main pulmonary artery. Now, on that image, that pulmonary artery doesn't look big. But we have to remember that CT doesn't have great, what we call negative predictive value. In other words, if I say it's not there as a sign, it doesn't necessarily mean the pulmonary artery pressure is not increased. It does have good positive predictive value. In other words, if that pulmonary artery was big, it's very likely that the pulmonary artery pressure in this patient has increased, but I can't exclude it on the basis of these images.
Okay, so we're in a position where we've got a 67-year-old gentleman, which means probably the most likely diagnosis without any more information at this stage probably would be idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, particularly in view of the fact we haven't got any rheumatological features in the history. We haven't got any outside triggers or exposures, but the imaging isn't quite what we would expect it to be. Is there any emphysema, Sujal? Athol mentioned that in the lung function assessment.
No, again, it's difficult because these are four snapshot images, but if we were going to see emphysema anywhere, it'd be somewhere either on that top left image or the top two images on the top row. Because emphysema, just like other diseases, generally parks itself in particular regions. So classically in smokers, we will see emphysema principally or first in the upper zones of the lungs. And I'm not seeing any on this scan.
Okay. So I think we would say that we need more information to be able to make a first choice diagnosis. And what we have decided to do in this case, and did decide to do, was to recommend a bronchoscopy. Now, Lisa, would you have done a bronchoscopy in this case at this stage? I'm interested to understand how other MDTs might consider.
Thanks, Pete. Sorry, I was just looking through the questions then. I think it's a tricky case. I think that you might discuss it with the patient and see if they were prepared to undergo the test based on the fact that it may or may not give a definitive answer and whether they wanted to go through it. I think you'd also have to look at the safety of that test. Obviously, the DLCO is a bit low, spirometry wasn't too bad. So I think it would be a reasonable discussion with the patient, but I think I'd want to make sure that it might make sure they know that it may or may not give us a definitive answer in the end.
Thank you. Yeah, well, I think that is what we did. And Athol, I might ask you to reflect on the bronchoscopy. Well, first of all, why we would have done a bronchoscopy? What information would we have been seeking?
Well, at present, without any further information, whether this is idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis or an alternative disorder is a very close call. If you're starting before you look at the scan with a likelihood just on the clinical details of maybe 75%, but you also know that disorder can often look different on a scan from a classical appearance, then you're pretty close to a 50-50 call. Either it's a disorder that will progress in spite of treatment and you will try to slow it down, or it is a disorder where you may very well be able to stabilize it with treatment or even achieve an improvement. So we diagnose to make these distinctions, and right now, on what we have, it is very close to a toss of a coin. And I'd expect to be talking to somebody using this language and then establishing that it is also a good idea to proceed as viewed by the patient. Now, that means I come to the bronchoalveolar lavage looking to see whether there is anything that tells me that a diagnosis other than idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is more likely. And what this does, at least, do you want me to comment on the diagnostic effect of the lavage?
Yes, please.
Yeah. What this does make unlikely is that this is an example of hypersensitivity pneumonitis. You saw on my slide that makes up about 20 to 25% of people with fibrotic lung disease. What it doesn't clearly discriminate is whether this is IPF or could be an autoimmune problem. This sort of profile is very often seen in both disorders. Neutrophils increased, that means the scarring, and not a lot else can be drawn from this. So it's one of those tests that if you get a certain profile, it's very helpful, but sometimes actually it doesn't really move the needle.
So we have to come to a diagnosis or at least a next step. So Athol, if you were handling, if this was a case you were bringing to the meeting, what conversations would you be having with the patient at this stage? And how would you be trying to formulate a logical diagnosis and treatment plan?
Well, firstly, I would be making it very clear that rather than being confident this is idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, we are genuinely somewhere close to a 50-50 call. I would then be saying that a surgical lung biopsy at this age should not be likely undertaken. Now, there are some centers that would still strongly recommend a surgical biopsy, but I think that the mortality, the risk of death, will in this scenario, with age of 67, with IPF a distinct possibility, it won't be the average 2%, so it may be of the order of 5% or higher. Now, there is a compromise here. Cryobiopsy is actually very good often at picking up that the diagnosis is very likely to be IPF. And for that reason, I would be discussing quite strongly the merits of finding this out. Because at present, we've got to choose between two quite different treatment approaches. Now, the whole value of a diagnosis is actually knowing what your treatment goals are, what drugs you should use, and how you should monitor. And we could take a provisional approach and work out a best approach without a lot of confidence, but know that it is a best approach. So to summarize, I think you have to have a conversation about a bronchoscopic biopsy procedure. And I'll stop at this point.
Well, the patient did not want to proceed with a bronchoscopic biopsy procedure, understandably. And we haven't really talked about cryobiopsy and what it entails, and perhaps we may do in the next case. But in any case, the patient was then made, we then made a diagnosis of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis on the basis of the imaging, the bronchoscopy, the clinical features, and the lung function tests. And unfortunately, the patient had lung function, which meant that they were outside of the range at which we could offer antifibrotic therapy. And this is an issue that is not for this meeting specifically, but the current commissioning criteria for antifibrotic therapies for IPF are a forced vital capacity FVC of between 50 and 80%. So we kept this patient under very close follow-up, of course, to monitor for any change in progression so that we were able to introduce treatment at the earliest possible time frame. We've talked a bit about cryobiopsy. Athol has talked previously about diagnostic confidence. I think it would be good to get to another case because we haven't got a huge amount of time. So we will talk Lisa. About... Yeah, sorry, Lisa.
Sorry to... just to say that we are trying to get those... FVC criteria for IPF lifted again. We are trying to do that. Also, I wonder, just because it might be an appropriate moment to put this question in, there's a question in the box about pulmonary hypertension, because you mentioned it earlier, and it might be just good to answer that just at this moment. If I could just find the question. Oh, I'm struggling here. It's bouncing around. I can't remember the exact wording. Maybe I can find it. There's been a few questions.
Well, I made the comment about pulmonary hypertension, so I think
I found the question. What is pulmonary hypertension? What causes it, and how would I know if I have it, and what effect will this have on me?
Yeah, might be just good to wrap that up now while we're there, if that's okay.
So that's four questions, but I think I can be reasonably brief. The lung function suggested there might be a problem in blood vessels. There are two types. One of them is there's an autoimmune problem. The second is the burden of the disease is putting enough pressure on blood vessels that the pressure in the lung blood vessels rises. When that happens, you have pulmonary hypertension. If you see that, that does worry you somewhat, because it is really telling you that the severity of the illness has reached a point that it is starting to stress blood vessels and sometimes the function of the right side of the heart. Now, there isn't really time to go into exactly what that means because it means different things in different people. I'm really only saying that because we don't have time to explore that. What I will say is that with the lung volumes being in the normal range, it would be disappointing if there was pulmonary hypertension, but you would still be looking for that, and Sujal commented on the likelihood. I think we would simply do an echocardiogram and a blood test to look at that possibility. It matters because it might change the outcome, and I'll stop at that point.
And perhaps, Athol, just to say, I'm not sure that you may have mentioned it, that some forms of pulmonary hypertension, when they coexist with lung fibrosis, can be treated with specific targeted drugs, which can improve patient symptoms and long-term survival. But conventionally thought pulmonary hypertension, which is secondary to lots of lung fibrosis, as we see in IPF, does not typically respond in that way, although there are some trials ongoing in that area. Would you say that's fair enough?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Pete, there's just a couple more questions maybe we could just do. Can pulmonary hypertension cause heart failure?
Yes, and that is unfortunately the where severe pulmonary hypertension leads to. It leads to the right side of the heart failing, which can cause more breathlessness and the oxygen levels dropping, absolutely.
Brilliant. Okay, should we move on to the next case then?
Thank you, Lisa. I think we probably only have time for this one case. So that this is why our MDT always overruns by about 3 hours, much to the chagrin of our radiologists, but who very kindly put up with us. So this is a case of a 70-year-old gentleman who gives a 12-month history of breathlessness. He had been exposed in his younger years when he'd been a builder to asbestos. And he has had Raynaud's syndrome for the past 8 years. And that's this condition I mentioned earlier where the fingertips can change colour in the cold and go white, blue or red, or combinations of those three, and can become painful and tingly. And that can be a sign of an autoimmune condition. But you can see that the patient had no other features of any autoimmune conditions or connective tissue diseases. Now in the blood test, there's an elevated aspergillus level. This is a precipitin. You remember, I did mention that these are things we look for, markers in the blood of exposures that may be relevant. So this is a mold protein. But the autoimmune blood test, the autoantibodies were negative. I'm trying to move on, but actually my clicker is not letting me, ABT team. I don't know if you can help. Perfect, thank you. Great. Athol, blood lung function test analysis.
The lung volumes, the top two, are at the bottom of the normal range. And we never know whether somebody was at that stage before they ever had illness or they were at 120% predicted and they've lost a huge amount. We just don't know what the lung function was in the past before the disease developed. The gas transfer of 50%, however, is helpful because it establishes that on a scale of 1 to 5 of badness, with 1 being the least severe, this DLCO is at a sort of stage 2, if you like, 2 out of 5. So the lung volumes are again a bit misleading. The truth data here on the severity lies in the DLCO. On this occasion, as judged by the KCO, it isn't lower than you might expect. There's no reason to think there's an added blood vessel problem or emphysema, but we'll see that or not on the scan. And the diagnosis is not really helped by this line of lung function numbers. That's it, I think.
Sujal, thoughts on the
image? Yeah, you have picked some nice difficult cases, Pete. So this one also is not straightforward in that, just like pathologists, radiologists, we spot patterns. And there are patterns we've seen before, and there are patterns which are a bit of a surprise to us. And this is a bit of a surprise. What can I see? Again, I see this sign of traction bronchiectasis. So in the top left image, there is a sort of Y-shaped structure, if you can see it, in sort of highlighted by white lung. And those are airways that are pulled open. And that tells me, again, whatever else is going on, there is fibrosis here. Then the top right image, I think is helpful. Because it's got a slightly different pattern to it. So we've got patchy areas of white lung, but that's interspaced by sort of polygonal, pentagonal areas of black lung. And those are sometimes fairly characteristic in what I think this might be. The lower two images show a similar combination of findings, a little bit of traction bronchiectasis, these low density, what we call low density lobules. So even though it's not classical, the radiology, it's certainly not UIP or IPF. UIP is the pathological radiological pattern. IPF is the clinical diagnosis. So it doesn't look like that, but I wonder whether this is a fibrotic hypersensitivity pneumonitis. And you did mention those precipitins. So it's sort of starting to fit, but the imaging is not absolutely classical.
Sujal, are there any features in the bottom which might have a perilobular slash organizing pneumonia appearance?
Yeah, and that's what was confusing me, because in the upper zones, it certainly looks very fibrotic. And in the lower zones, you're quite right. It's got that sort of perilobular look. But I wonder whether that's just fibrosis.
Can you describe perilobular for us, Sujal? What does that mean?
So a lobule is a structure that the pathologist will recognize and we see on a CT scan. It's a unit of lung structure, which is quite important diagnostically. And what it comprises is a roughly pentagonal or hexagonal structure into which an airway goes, which we call the lobular airway, and it's accompanied by the lobular artery. And then that lobular airway divides further and further and further, gives off what we call the terminal ducts, and then leads to the alveoli where the gas exchange takes place. But that lobule, as I said, the pathologist and Alex can talk about this, is a unit which is quite useful because the distribution of disease within that lobule can be diagnostically important. So when we talk about perilobular, it's around the edge of the lobule. Once you see it, I mean, I wish I could sort of highlight it using my mouse arrow, but it doesn't seem to work on this. But anything around the edge of that lobule we call perilobular. And when we see that pattern, we think about a pathological diagnosis of something called organizing pneumonia. So I see exactly what you're seeing here, Pete, but with the other features, I wonder whether this is a hypersensitive pneumonitis as opposed to an organizing pneumonia pattern. But it's another difficult case.
Alex, people hear organizing pneumonia and they think it's an infection, because some patients will have fibrotic organizing pneumonia, but is that related to bacterial infections?
So organizing pneumonia is a histological pattern. So it's the body's response to clearing away an inflammatory or exudate. And that can be caused by quite a number of features. So it's not just an infection that's resolving. It might be somebody who's had an episode of acute lung injury. Perhaps they've inhaled some smoke or they're on the ITU for another reason. It can be caused by a drug reaction. So it's a pattern that we see, but it isn't solely caused by an infection. There are a number of features. It's a healing pattern, a bit like if you had an ulcer on your skin, you're forming some granulation tissue at the base of that ulcer. It's effectively the same process in the lung.
Athol, I think did you want to come in?
I think it might be helpful before we go to the cryobiopsy to try to reach conclusions on what the diagnosis may be. As I read this, we have two broad possibilities: a form of hypersensitivity pneumonitis or an underlying autoimmune disorder. Now, both of these involve misbehavior of the immune system. Both might be managed with the same therapies, but the importance of hypersensitivity pneumonitis is you will then search rigorously for something that might be triggering the problem. So I've got an open mind in this case. And just to stress, we are talking about perhaps the 15% of people who have the most difficult cases when we look at these two cases.
And I thought maybe I'll just push you on that a little bit, because when we discuss cryobiopsy with our patients, we explain to them that it's a bronchoscopic procedure. So it's done under bronchoscopy, with them essentially sedated to the point of being asleep, so almost a general anaesthetic. It's a procedure which is done by expert bronchoscopists under X-ray guidance, so they can see what part of the lung they're accessing, and they take a biopsy sample, which is not as big as a surgical biopsy, but of course more information than you would get just with a normal bronchoscopy. But it does have some risks. So we quote bleeding risk of about 10% on average, and we say that the lung might collapse in about 10% of cases, depending on the operator. And if the lung collapses, the patient might need to have a tube put in to reinflate the lung. So I guess it's not a decision that it's not a conversation that we have lightly with patients. So there has to be real value, I think, in doing so. And perhaps in this case, we might also have thought about the fact that if the biopsy showed features which looked more like UIP or idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, we might have gone back to our MDT and said, well, the imaging doesn't look like it's idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, but the biopsy is giving us more information to lead us in that direction, and that might change our treatment approach. Would you argue against that?
Yes, I would, I think, because half of the people with a biopsy pattern of UIP don't have IPF. Now, if you have IPF, you will always have that pattern. But this can also occur in some people with hypersensitivity pneumonitis and some people with autoimmune disease. And the value of knowing that, and cryobiopsy can be very helpful in picking this up, is that you then expect a more aggressive course. Now, having said this, I would be very surprised if we found UIP at a cryobiopsy in this case, having seen the scan. So to me, the value is whether you can see evidence of what is driving what I would hope would be a good outcome with the right treatment and approach. And here you're distinguishing between evidence of something in the environment where it might then be crucial to go beyond usual searching to find that, or something that is driven by the immune system from within. So that's the value of cryobiopsy here. I will also say that this is a case in which it is a close call, because you can say that the broad treatment approach will be very similar for these two possibilities, but the extra information might turn out to be very important. And whenever a biopsy is a close call, if the patient has a strong view either way, it is no longer a close call, all things being equal otherwise. Personally, I would opt for a cryobiopsy, but I have to confess that this is one of those 60-40 decisions.
Alex, would you mind talking us through what the biopsy did show?
Of course. So when we get a biopsy, as you've heard, we will either get a surgical lung biopsy or a cryobiopsy. So we're getting a small piece of tissue compared to the radiologists who are looking at a section of the whole lung. So as Pete mentioned previously, it's important that the bronchoscopists or the surgeons who are taking the tissue sample have discussed the case at the MDT to identify the bit of tissue that's best to biopsy to get us those features that we need to see. When we look at a biopsy, we analyze it again in a very similar way to the radiologist. So we look at each of the anatomical compartments. We look at the small airways and the distal airways, those are the airways we see on the biopsy. We look at the alveolar structures, which is the sort of spongy tissue that you can see in the picture in the top left-hand corner. And we also look at the vessels. So we look at the anatomical compartments, and then we look for the changes, the pathological changes in each of those compartments and the type of changes we see, be they fibrotic or inflammatory or other conditions. So if you look at the top left-hand picture, this is a cryobiopsy which shows alveolar parenchyma. It has quite a spongy appearance normally. There's very little pink staining there, which is an indication of collagen. So the alveolar walls are quite thin. If we look at the bottom left-hand picture, you can see that actually there is something going on around an airway. There's an airway in the middle of the picture. And around that, you can see almost like a tendril of spider's legs almost, or tentacles of a jellyfish, say. And that's where you're getting a process that indicates that the epithelium of the alveolar walls is changing to a more bronchialized epithelium. So you're getting bronchiolar, peribronchiolar metaplasia, which indicates that there's something injurious going on to that airway. So the process appears to be airway centered. If you look at the bottom right-hand picture, you can see that alongside the normal alveolar spaces in the top right-hand corner, at the bottom, you've got that sort of plug of pale tissue that's sitting partly in an alveolar space, partly adjacent to an alveolar wall, and that's what we call a bud of organizing pneumonia. And then if we look at the top right-hand corner, you can see there's lots of blue dots and some pale cells sitting within it. And that's a pattern of inflammation that we describe as a granuloma or a microgranuloma in this case. So we can see that the disease process is mainly airway centered, that it's characterized by some organizing pneumonia and a pattern of inflammation that has these microgranulomas. And when you see that combination of features, that is quite a typical pattern for hypersensitivity pneumonitis.
Thank you, Alex, that's perfect. So on that basis, we were able to make a diagnosis of hypersensitivity pneumonitis based on the imaging and the biopsy and the blood test. Aware of the fact that we are at risk of outstaying our welcome, I think we only have 5 minutes left for a Q&A, and I'll hand over to you to ask any questions that have come up.
Thanks, Pete. That was really, really interesting. I'm sure the patients will have found that fascinating. Appreciate for the patients, obviously, when we're in a meeting like this, this is like a real live meeting and the doctors are using language that it's quite hard for you to understand every terminology. And, you know, it's difficult to translate everything. We've tried to do it a bit, but hopefully you'll get a feel for the complexity and the debate that goes on in a good MDT.